Call meeting order 6:01.
Second.
Mark Sant.
Mike Volpone.
Dave Roll.
Michelle Hoff.
I'll go finish your committee.
Celine Muldowney.
Dan Streeter, Open Space Committee.
Reading the minutes from the previous meeting, Celine has sent these out. I don't know if anybody's got a chance to read them. I'm fine with it. If anybody wants to take a copy, I've got one here. If you'd like to take a look, front and back. I didn't see any issues.
Did you get them?
I spelled mannequin differently, but that's just me.
I sent you a message. I didn't copy. I just looked through it quickly.
Alright.
It didn't come up on spell check.
Is it MANEQYN?
There are different spellings on it.
That's the only I would know. I didn't know what it was.
There's a French spelling.
Oh, okay. Any questions?
Make a motion to accept the minutes as presented.
Do I hear a second?
I second.
Any discussion? All's in favor? All's opposed? I have it.
Right, the same thing.
Okay. Any correspondence?
No.
Any bills and claims?
Bills.
Yeah, because I was gonna say that and the stuff that you hit us with the emails tonight, I think we can possibly put those under this if you want to go over that.
Okay.
I don't know if we can do the fiscal year stuff, but I think the other stuff, I think we can.
Right now, we have a bill payable to Meadows Construction for the field house. They would like us to sign off on it. I've looked through the contract work and whatnot, and everything seems to be in order.
Who filled that out? The town?
Yes.
No, that's fine.
And then in conjunction with that, it was recommended that we authorize an individual to sign this on behalf of the committee, whose job is, I wrote back in your email about reporting back, so that if it's time sensitive, like it will be coming down at the end of the year, who's ever designated can sign it and just report back versus waiting for a meeting to get everybody's signature. If we don't form, it delays their payment. So first step is, can we sign off on this?
That's the document, just so we can, it saves us the time of having to do all the stuff?
No.
Yeah, this is the document that I normally.
Yeah, we usually send around.
And the idea is.
What is this, the balance?
That is what is being paid by us.
Oh, the balance, I guess is rough.
And if we want to nominate and authorize a member, expedite this process, their responsibilities include but not limited to reviewing any.
It's still new, don't worry about it. I mean, as long as we have a quorum to do without it.
Call it, help.
They review it, make, identify any discrepancies, resolve the discrepancies, bring it back to.
I did ask for it.
The accountant, make sure everything's in order and sign off on it. Come back here and tell us what we did. Basically, anything that we've authorized payment for, we can do. Things that we didn't authorize or are not aware of, we need to red flag. So there's.
Kidding me?
$40,000.
That's $11,000 over budget. $229 is what we were priced.
And it came in.
At $240?
Total complete and stored, $241.
So it's $11 over that even.
$241.
And that's what we're discussing.
Okay.
If we have questions about it, we can bring it up, but if we can just sign it. If you have questions, if you have questions.
Do you have a question?
No, no question.
I don't know if we can bring that up in new business, because it wasn't supposed to, but that's what I was saying. Under bills and claims, I think we can still get under it. I'll have you do that one.
So is what you're saying, we should nominate someone that's going to.
We don't have to. It is recommended so that if a bill comes in, yeah, we can make somebody do it.
Who recommended this?
I'm not local, that's my problem.
I've been doing most of the bills, so.
Would you like?
I don't know if you want to keep it in the same wheelhouse.
It'd be great, but I'd want to add to your list.
What do you think about that?
That's fine, as long as we have somebody who is accessible.
Fairly accessible.
I nominate Celine to be authorized to sign our bills and report back to the committee.
Is she trustworthy?
Don't comment, no smile, no nothing.
I trust her.
Alright, any discussion?
Is she trustworthy?
No, I think she's very trustworthy, as on the record too. No discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? You have it.
Is it a motion or a nomination?
That was a motion.
Motion to nomination.
Question is, should we swear on it or not?
She's swearing it out.
Can you just swear your name and then?
Do I don't sign it? Not a whole thing. Yeah.
Does that cover your piece?
Yep, that covers this part, yeah.
Can we go over the amount?
Which other one?
The over the amount, or do we have to wait that till next week when we put up the list?
Yeah.
It wasn't on the agenda because I wasn't sure, I didn't realize we were adding it to it, but I could certainly get on for next. I just didn't know if we could swear, because technically it is a bill, and it's under bills and claims. I think we can talk about it, and that's why I was curious to see, am I okay with that or am I reaching?
We might have to go legal. Legal. Maybe?
No.
We should probably just wait until next week. Is that okay?
It's kind of the essence of that conversation, or?
I don't know, I wasn't privy to that part of the conversation, that's what I'm asking. If it's a big issue, it's like, do we need to do it now, or is it something we can wait?
Are we allowed to add things to the agenda if they're?
Technically, we're not allowed to, that was the worst, like my hand slapped about a year ago. Because I was putting in other things, and they said, I can't have that, you have to have the list which we're gonna discuss. So I said, okay.
So what's your answer to that? Did we discuss it or not discuss it?
I just think it's a gray area, I think we can get around it, as long as we discuss it now in the bills and claims.
If you wanna bring it up.
I'd like, or then, so under bills and claims, based on the amount, I think was $240,000. The original request was $220.
$241.
$200. Then we came in with the RFP at $229, and now they're talking $240 and change, so it was $241,000.
Yep.
Is that including the amount?
No.
I'm sorry, it was $200 and then?
Then the RFP came back at $229,000, and that's what we agreed to. Now they've come in with a budget, a bill of $240 and whatever the.
As a committee in an advisory capacity, we made recommendations to the town regarding the amount of monies to be spent. They looked at the bids that came in and felt that this particular bid was in, within regulations, and they could accept the bid, which they did, and fulfilled the contract.
Can I go on the record and say, how many bids did we have?
I believe one.
That's what I was saying, I don't think we had a choice in the matter.
Well, there's always choices, decisions being made, go forward with it, and the additional monies would be coming out, a certain percentage of the monies would be coming out of the Recreation Committee budget. Again, we're.
Certain percentage or the balance?
I was informed that a certain amount would be coming from our budget. I don't remember what the number was.
Was it 29 or 41?
Don't remember.
Yeah, this might have been, if the job's complete, there might have been add-ons that the town, I think we talked about, there were some kind of things that the town required, so, which we didn't know about, and those may be the reason why it went from 230 to 241. I'm guessing, I don't know.
So, are we discussing that there is a discrepancy, or what, or difference, balance, or are we?
I think that's something for the town manager.
Yeah, well, the town manager and the accountant have determined what we owe, and that's all we need to do.
So.
Okay.
I guess the question is, how much are we as a committee being charged for that? Is it $41,000 or $30,000?
I think it's the $21 we just signed.
$21 we just signed up on.
Okay.
Okay, then there's.
So I guess the other question, I'm sorry, were we originally gonna get a hit for $31,000 and now it's gone down to $21? Am I mistaken on that?
No, I think it was always $21.
No, I always thought it was 29.
I thought it was 30, yeah, 29.
It was 200 was the original one we had, they had allotted, we got agreed upon. So that was being taken care of by the town. Anything over that was coming out of our budget, and last I had heard, it was $229,000, so that additional 29 is getting taken out of our town.
All right, well, then I guess we just... It's good.
That's a good thing, then?
Yeah.
I like that, then.
Perfect.
Okay.
Okay, so now we're bills and claims. The old business right now, which is the only thing I have on the agenda for today, is discuss the fee schedule and all the pieces that pertain to it. So, everybody's homework last week was to grab your towns, we weren't here, so you get to listen and hear all the fun stuff. And I'll have Mark give you a quick, actually, Celine, why don't you probably get it easier to give you a quick synopsis on what we're doing here? If you wanna update.
So, we were kind of asked to review some of the policies and procedures and fees that were in place, just to kind of bring them up to date, since they're 10 years old. And so we reviewed the policy and procedures for the fields, that's already been done. And the next thing we took on was the fees. And we basically just, we weren't gonna do any, you know, it was basically just where do we compare to other towns? And we went around and looked at what all the local towns do on the North Shore, both regional and non-regional, and how they break out their fees for the fields. And we are the only ones that charge per player. Anywhere. Everybody charges per hour.
There might be a change in that, but yes.
Okay. Oh, Ainsbury does? Okay. So obviously the fees are kind of all over the place, and the reason to do this is not to increase our fees, it's just to see kind of where we are in comparison to the other towns, just so that we kind of are, you know, in the ballpark or so. And it also kind of gets rid of some other issues that have been happening on the per player. We have no way of generating a bill because we're relying on the teams to give us their rosters, so that's kind of a little backwards, not that we don't trust them, but and then there's just a when they pay per player, they can rent as many hours as they want. And so then other people can't use it because it's basically
they take the whole field.
So we're just trying to make it a little more
town friendly.
Yeah, bring in some other people or have open fields that aren't rented for a period of time, so someone can go through the ball. I think that pretty much covers it.
Dan, you served on the rec committee years ago. What was your experience back then, and how could you shed light?
Well, I mean, you know, it's interesting because there are no sports group people here, you know, and so I think everything was sort of driven by the sports group people, and you know, I think we were just fumbling around trying to figure out how to, you know, I think we took a lot of advice from the sports groups, and sort of maybe, I don't know if the situation is much the same as it was back then, you know, I mean, soccer, lacrosse, you know, they just sort of figure out how they fit it all, and, you know, then the football and the cheerleaders, I don't even know what groups are still left, you know, and then there was always the contentious thing
at this point, recreation committee is not the fields used by Newbury Byfield baseball, softball, not under the jurisdiction of the recreation.
They used to have Pearson Field, and that's it. It's theirs.
That, and they use the upper green.
And the Newbury Elementary School, and the softball fields and stuff.
Yeah. So that is something we discussed down the road, but at the current, we have a club team, GPS. We have Triton Youth Soccer. They both do spring and fall services. Triton Youth Lacrosse uses two fields in the spring. Triton Pop Warner has not had the numbers to field the football team. A number of them went to the Cape Ann League. The Triton Cheer had a waiver for this year, for this past season, past fall. Typically, Pop Warner requires you to have a football team, to have a cheer team, so we don't know where they stand. And then we also, not last summer, but in summers prior, the high school boys and girls soccer team would use the fields during the summer for their, what do you call it?
Summer league.
Summer league, captain's practice type thing. External, non-sport users include the Byfield Art, Byfield Community Art Center through their art and music festival. That's a one-day event. That's it now. It used to be.
Yeah, the lacrosse tournament stuff.
The lacrosse tournament stopped. They're holding up a pipe stage now. Last year we held a soccer tournament with GPS. They're not going to come back. I'll explain that in just a second. And then Circus Marcus had been using it for a three-day event. Once the septic went in, it was not conducive environment for them. They went out. They moved their program out to Spencer Pierce. The lacrosse tournament after in years prior, the police and fire were not as engaged in it. Maybe they weren't invited. So the cost to Tuckett lacrosse was substantially less. 2 years ago, fire and police said we need to be there, and the building for the number of days and the officers was way out of budget for what Pentucket was anticipating. Plus, at that time, the septic was being repaired, so they had to have bus services from the high school to the field. Same thing with Byfield Arts that year. They decided not to come back because it was just too expensive, the $5,000 for the weekend. Police and fire that year was about $5,000. Last Memorial Day, we kept it at $5,000, and the police and fire went up to $8,000. And GPS, by their reported that they lost, broke even, they lost money on the event. So what was a money, a fundraiser for Pentucket ends up costing people, just to get on the field, $12,000.
Yeah, I mean, that's too bad.
Mm-hmm. And that's been a,
seems a little overdone to me, but.
I think the issue is, we work with the police, if there, and fire, if there is a way to reduce those costs. It's not for conversation now, but that's something that we'll reevaluate. It had been a nice tradition in town to bring local communities here, local sport teams.
I think that, way back when, that was, was an income producer. And, it's kind of interesting to hear all this, because I don't know,
mm-hmm.
You guys have a real budget now. We were just trying to, get stuff done with whatever fees we
could. The restructure of the budgets and all that, about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, where all of a sudden now a lot of our things, so the maintenance of the fields was under one department, now it falls in ours. So we've got a lot for that each year. And so we're kind of moving ahead with the field house, but then all of a sudden we've added these other things, and we've got a basketball court we're trying to work on, playground we're trying to work on, program that we're trying to work on, and right now all of a sudden our budget, as you see, when they take out $21,000 and then we take out additional money for different things, all of a sudden it's like, what happened? So we're trying to work through it to kind of move on at this point. So one of the things we did at the last meeting was discuss the various different pieces. So we wanted to look at, I'm going to make sure I'm doing the right thing. So we have five areas, discuss them for moving forward and changes to five areas: the fee structure, tiers, rental policies, rain dates, and the field house, and then crisscrossing the field usage. So last meeting we asked everybody to grab a couple of towns. We'd already kind of done it, but we wanted to see more from a tier structure, how it looked, how the various towns handled rain dates and refunds. And that was kind of where we were hoping to get through tonight. So, Michelle, I'll let you start with what you found in your towns.
Well, I looked up Amesbury. I didn't end up getting a hold of anybody who will call me back for the information, but they do have, they do per player, but that's for an adult structure team. They don't charge if you, they have 85% of Amesbury residents for the youth recreation. They must get a roster.
What if I get 0 to 4 hours is $100?
Well, it is for non-residents, it's $100. For residents, if you have it, if you, do you want it like an out-of-town league so that you can say GPS had 85% of their league was there and they were all, 85% were from Amesbury. They could rent it or like single use or an event, like say a tournament. And then the structure goes a little bit differently. But they have a stipulation at the bottom that rainouts and postponements may be rescheduled by contacting the youth recreation director. They don't guarantee rescheduling for rainouts and postponements and will not refund any fees after the facility's been paid and reserved with, if it's not used. You can request refunds, but they have to be 7 days prior to the resolution.
Can I just see that?
Yeah.
So they're not guaranteeing rescheduling and rainouts.
Right.
And they're not refunding any
money. I think you would have to do 7 days prior to
the resolution. 7 days prior. Which is
weird.
Well, you gotta understand though, there's when I did speak to somebody in Ipswich and asked about like how they do things, she didn't even have an answer for rainouts or postponements because they don't even charge they don't charge anybody that's within the town and they don't rent to anybody that's not in the town. They could, but they have never had in all the years of doing it had to rent to anybody outside of the town. So they only have ever been given, like they have this information as to what it would be if there's less than 50% Ipswich residents, it's $20 an hour. If it's 50% Ipswich residents, it's $15 an hour. If it's 100% Ipswich residents, it's no charge for any of the field use.
And it's always been 100%.
And they have always been 100%. It's not regionalized, so. That's probably the reason. They also have an online calendar, so if you wanted to reschedule, you just go right online and do that to find out what's available. So she couldn't, I said, so what would you do if somebody, that she couldn't give me an answer because in all the issues.
And there's no situation that didn't make sense.
Yeah.
I will say I did email the town administrator to ask what, if we made this change, how would it be managed? Because I manage the calendar,
yeah.
Or somebody else manages the books. She hasn't gotten back to me yet. Because there has to be a one point person.
Right.
And then there are a number of towns that do the online,
Which would be a lot easier at that point. Cause
yeah, I'd have to look into what kind of programs those are.
Who else, who had the Pawtucket stuff?
I did, and.
I'm just curious, before you said that was in town.
Yeah.
I have a regional as well, and they actually, their hourly rates and are way a lot higher. So.
Well, Merrimack has nothing. Groveland has nothing. West Newbury, the Board of Selectmen sets the fees and can waive them except for the athletic fields, which is approved by the Parks and Recreation, which they set the fees. And none of it's published online, so it was kind of like,
okay.
They do this and this do that. The only thing I did get out of it is that their tier structure is very basic. It's either you're in-town nonprofit or you're out-of-town and
yep, same here.
And some kind of accountability for it being a regional, like in-town youth sports is still part of the regional. It would be Groveland, Merrimack, even though, you know, it's not.
Do they do rosters?
No. No. It wasn't very informative.
So you have no idea? Because mine right here just showed field rates, tier one.
Who were you?
I had Topsfield at Masco.
Yeah.
Topsfield did not have anything on their website They had a couple of links to like Bradley State Park and some other places, but nothing regarding to it, so I went to the Masco site and pulled up from them. I tried to call some, but I couldn't get any answer information back. But on their website, their field use rates are for tier one, which is with 100% participants of the tri-town residents. It's $70 an hour with 2 hour minimum.
I'm sorry, when you say Masco, are you talking to the Masco Regional School District?
Yes.
Okay, so it's a school district versus a town.
Yeah, so this would say, this is sort of like what we have on our situation. We have multiple towns.
No, it's
different.
Masco versus Triton.
Yeah.
Masco versus Triton.
And Masco's talking about, I assume, the fields at their high school, middle school.
Yeah.
Not Topsfield, not Box.
Topsfield won't accept anybody, because I caught them a while ago. They don't do any out of town people.
I have on my chart, I'm sorry, you want to finish?
No, go ahead.
Topsfield was $1,500 per sport per season.
I think that sounds right. I think that they said they just, it's like, it was a flat rate, but they don't take, they won't do any out of town. They tried that once and they are against it.
Which would make sense, because if you can do that, if you only have, if you're doing in your town, you only have one soccer.
Right.
Organization you have to deal with, and you don't have to worry about competing people using that soccer field. It'll only be that track when you do soccer. You pick that field. So you could just do a flat rate and know that you can book it out. Nobody else is competing for that field. Right?
Agreed. You were going down to tiers though?
The second tier was anybody that was not to qualify for a tier one, it had to be 100% of the tri-town residents. If it's beyond that, it's $85 an hour with a 2 hour minimum. They do have a refund policy that if the school cancels it, they can, MRSD may provide a full refund of all payments or provide an opportunity for future field use. If it's raining though, it just says you shouldn't play. It doesn't mention anything about a refund in that situation. And theirs sounds like more like it's towards an event, not a season type of situation.
Jordy, my people are just Marco.
Go ahead.
Beverly, I called them. You already know the tiers section of Beverly. When I talked to the secretary, she said there's no friends, refunds. She says, I don't remember ever writing a check for any refunds, so they just don't give refunds.
But do you have out of town?
What's that?
Is there out of town stuff? Or?
Yeah, they...
They have five tiers.
Yeah, and she said that she's never, so they just don't do refunds.
Okay.
You know?
And they were $50 an hour?
Something like that.
For an outside user?
Yeah. They don't charge for their field house or bathrooms. DPW takes care of that. They do charge for lights, and I don't know what the charge was. It's like $20 or something like that.
Ipswich shuts that as well.
Yeah. They say rain dates are just rescheduled. You know, they work that if they can. So I did Boxford. And the interesting thing about Boxford is they have all these fields, and they're beautiful fields. I mean, they're absolutely gorgeous. But Boxford is all their fields, surprisingly, the town-owned land are run by the Boxford Athletic Association, which is a private group. So everything, you know, the town has nothing. They don't receive any income from the fields. The Boxford Athletic Association runs those. And they were getting, you know, like I was reading some of the things, they were like anywhere between $40 or $50 per head for the year for their kids. So I don't know how they calculate that or whatever. And I get nothing else from them about, you know, there was no, I checked the website, I didn't go to talk to anyone from the Boxford. I just figured, well, that wasn't anything that we were interested in, so I
can I just ask? Amesbury and Ipswich have a recreation person?
Ipswich is through the Cemetery and Parks Commission.
But they have a person that does the scheduling. It's not...
They have paid staff.
Yes.
Hamilton has paid staff, too. I talked to the guy from Hamilton.
Sean?
I believe so. He's a Salisbury guy.
Yeah.
Really nice guy. He said they charge, so it's Hamilton 1. And so they don't have any problems as far as that. They charge $10 a person for like their baseball leagues and the you know, whoever plays in the field, but it's $10 a person. So they know, they have like these chunks of money, they just know they're coming in all the time.
Which is why ours was set up originally that way.
Yeah, yeah. And he said that if they don't have a ton of fields, one thing they did have, I think Patton Park, maybe the other one, there's another area, I think Patton, some, there's two areas in Hamilton, one area, and I think both have facilities, and he said again, they leave those open 24 hours a day, and then again, that's DPW takes care of that. Department of Public Works comes by every morning and just makes sure that they're clean, and so it's a DPW thing. He said that if you wanted to rent a field and you're outside, it's $25 to $30 an hour for their fields. So that's where you have to come. Is he part-time, full-time, do you know?
He's on the board over at Salisbury.
He's what?
He's on the board over at Salisbury. As an employee, he works there.
Yeah.
In
yeah.
Is on the board.
Yeah, no, I didn't know if it was a full-time position.
You're up, Mark.
Okay. First with Newburgh Port, I've been on the phone, not getting any response back. Not much on their website. I talked to some of the users. Some of the fields are run through the soccer organization, and people essentially sublet it from them, and they just pay them a certain fee. I will continue pursuing Newburgh Port. I've tried twice last week and twice today.
So in my initial, I don't know, I sent this out a long time ago, just so that you know, my initial research was $50 an hour nonprofit, $75 an hour profit for in-town users, and then $100 an hour for out-of-town users. But that, do they have turf now?
They have turf in the high school season.
They're not down on the
Full, no.
Not Fuller.
Right. So I don't know if that's a guy that you can kind of.
The next thing was.
Did you have West Newbury? No, that was me. You just had Newbury Port?
Newbury Port, actually, I made the assumption that it was Newbury Port and Triton. Because
okay.
Triton was covered, because we didn't cover Rowley or Salisbury.
Right.
And they're part of our regional. Let's go back to one member, Newbury. The baseball fields are signed up by Newbury Byfield Baseball's softball via the Board of Selectmen. They make an application, Board of Selectmen approves it, there's no money provided. It has did some maintenance, which sort of goes to what Salisbury does. They're not doing that at this point, is my understanding. They meaning the baseball organization would cut the grass, maybe edge the infield, turn over the infield. I remember doing that with softball behind Newbury Elementary. They're in charge of their own schedule, so they get to make up games and use it. They are willing and have been available to have other people use it if there's no game scheduled.
So did you say that town no longer cuts it?
Or no, the town cuts it.
Okay, so that group does no longer,
they
demands on it.
At the last conversation I have, I don't have anything in writing, the town was cutting grass. In years past, the baseball organization would cut the grass, edge some of the stuff. I don't know about fertilizing, liming, on all that other maintenance stuff. And when I say cut, I'm under the assumption, and I could be wrong, They're talking about the field behind us, by the library, the Pearson Field, not necessarily the upper green. I don't remember if them, if they cut them, I don't know.
I would imagine they do, I don't think, there's no.
Who cuts the school grounds?
That, that would imagine the town cuts that, or they hire out a.
The NES, my understanding is it's a contract through Triton Regional. So they would be dealing with three different themselves, DPW and the Triton contract. Salisbury, they're new, and a lot of their policies were adopted from Hamilton Wenham. Refunds, while available, are usually given as a credit. Some of it's a bureaucratic, trying to get back $17, there's a lot of paperwork, and it's easier to say that next year. What's, they have a tiered system, they have a, they don't have a five tier. And again, if you look at these different tier programs, they're basically all the same coming out of Peabody and Danvers from years ago. It's nothing, you know, the five tiers about between 90 and 100, and then there's the sport, youth sports, and then the nonprofits, profits and private camps. And so this is to make sure that anybody who wants to use it falls into a category. Same application process that we have and use of the field.
How many tiers do we have then?
They have five. Well, a lot of them are doing the residency because they're playing, you're paying per player. And the idea is, and my understanding of this group, was at one point, Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, it was, I'm gonna say like $25 a head for Triton programs. And that's why they had a list of the names. We used to collect a list with names and town of residence. And then for the club programs, they were paid at higher rates. Is that what it was back then?
Yeah, I mean, I know.
What it is now?
I don't really recall exactly, but I don't think it was, even for the club teams, I don't think it was by the hour.
No, it was by the player.
You're coming in, you know, this time slot, you know, was less times involved than the town youth soccer, the Triton youth soccer, I would say.
That's Salisbury Rowley. They have the Aries Park area, and what was interesting is they do basically a set fee, and they will ask them, they will pay a certain amount. Say if they have a $4,000 bill, they'll pay $2,500 in the beginning of the season. And then if they have rain days and can't make up the games, those extra days get deducted, and then their final check is paid. So if they...
Who keeps track of the organization, Reggie?
No, it appeared to be one of the committee members. And basically, my takeaway from the from users of Newburyport, Raleigh, Salisbury, there's a lot of working together between the users and the managers of the field. That we gotta figure out how this works to make it work. And it might mean lacrosse uses it this in the morning, the games on Saturday, and soccer, you need to reschedule over this and just make it fit all the pieces in. What I got from Newburyport is there is a limited number of space with the number of teams that they have. A lot of towns have that problem where they can't have unfettered access to it that we didn't have because there's just so many teams.
One thing that the guy from Hamilton did say was that he receives calls, he said every day, I don't know if he was exaggerating, but he receives calls all the time about using fields. And he said, we don't have that many to use, but he said that, you know, there are all sorts of people out there asking. And, you know, they, like I said, they're $20, $25 an hour, and they can only, they have a certain amount that they can use. So there are, you know, I don't think that when we were thinking about fee amounts, I don't think we were, I think we were still on the low side.
We're really low.
Yeah.
But we were trying to keep everybody somewhat whole.
Yeah.
Based on the numbers they were submitting, and
Yep.
Bills they were paying.
So we converted it from per head to hour, we were trying to find out back the hour and say, okay, where would it be based on the hours they have, how would it equal up to money wise?
Especially for the youth sports.
Yeah, the youth sports I'm totally good with, you know, trying to.
Cause this hasn't been, just for your information, this hasn't been updated since 2006, it's been over 12 years since this was, so. I have the new report one, I'm just happening to be looking at it, cause they have a lot of different fields, but it's, and all they ask for is donations. It's specifically set on their one day application, but they've got Atwood Park, a basketball court, tennis court, Brown School, Cashman Park, basketball and tennis courts, Cushing Park, Joppa Park at Seawall, Jason Sawyer Playground on Palm Island, Marches Hill. I mean, they, Molesey Pines, Molesey Woods, Bartlett Mall, the rail trail, I mean, all these things they.
Those aren't fields.
Fields, yeah.
No, I'm saying, but these are all the different places they have on their application. So if you want to use it, these are all things you can grab. But there is no fee structure listed on anywhere on that thing. It's listed as a donation. The high school has fees.
So where does that leave us?
We just ask them for a big donation, and if they don't give it to us, we don't give them access to the fee.
I mean, are we really wrong with the 5 and 50? I think my feeling is if we're going to do refunds, I would rather go 10 and 20.
I would not, I'd rather credit time than.
Yeah, and like.
But how do you credit that? I mean, just give it, you're gonna have to give it back on.
Next year.
The question is who's gonna, well, first of all, we have to figure, I think we have to take it all in different chunks. Like, one, are we gonna make this change? Two, what's a reasonable rate? Three, how's it gonna be tiered? Four, how's it gonna be implemented, which may bring us back to number one again, you know?
Let's go back to the beginning.
It's with that whole tier and the whole thing with the field house, you know, that's going to sort of morph into this in a way, right? Because Mark, you were saying that when we were discussing the use of the field house with the fields, should we be thinking of that on a daily basis that is just not for the teams that are playing there, but also, you know, Sally and Jim that decide to take their dog for a walk on the field and then they just want to use the bathroom. So it's more of a public.
The mental model I was operating from, and I don't know if it was conveyed in the proposals that I sent out earlier.
Yeah.
Building is designed to block off the concession area from the meeting area from the bathroom area. The concept would be to keep the bathrooms available as the original purpose of this building during the sport times, primarily after school, Monday through Friday, from say 2 o'clock to 7 o'clock, so the public could have access to it. And then it would be locked up. On weekends, it would probably be from say 8 o'clock to 8, where whoever uses the field has it, people come and walk their dogs, have it. To accommodate those who are using facilities when that is not open, we'd be having one port, handicap accessible porta potty. The meeting area could be available to the teams. It could be open and left open. Again, part of the purpose of the building is to provide some shelter to inclement weather. It was more designed for the summer to increase usability during summer, where kids tend to be there for longer periods of time than most practices are an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours during spring and fall. So then, if there was summer programming, you could continue in that building. So during the spring and fall, the bathrooms would be open, the meeting area could be open. I've also written into it that it could be opened upon request if a person needed to meet and have a conversation outside off the field, it would be available to them. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if people wanted to rent it or regularly schedule it as a public building in town, like the library, there'd be a process where they could just reserve it for little or no cost if they're meeting, say, on a regular basis. the men's coffee club. They could meet there.
What were the breakdowns that again? You said change the process. You went through a bunch. One, two, three, four, five. I'm sorry to catch you, but I want to write it down.
Yeah.
But I'd like to go through, because I think it was a good idea, and we're literally just gonna go right through.
Yeah.
Do we want to make this change?
Yeah.
What do we want to make this change to? How many tiers do we want to have? How is it gonna be implemented? Which might bring us back to number one again. How does renting the field house dovetail into it? And those policies? Does that sound right? I find it interesting that the DPW is the one that takes care of the bathrooms and all these other things.
We don't have a DPW. Contractual services, I wanted to say $50 a week.
But I just, I, that, that's.
I was just thinking, it's not their house.
Typically, every town that I talked to said their DPW does the maintenance on the buildings. There wasn't an outside.
Because who's gonna be actually, in the big picture, who's the one responsible for making sure the septic gets done and the.
Us. We will work, as we are currently, work closely with DPW and because of their oversight and being a professional staff, if we, for example, with the septic, if we said our SPN, we had budgeted for an annual, we would work with them to make sure somebody was there to monitor, because I don't know, as volunteers, we're gonna have as much availability. But we could ask one of their staff to be there to make sure that happens. And there's gonna be a closer, these things will require a close working relationship with DPW, as we have now. They're, I think, very receptive to our ideas and.
Well, I'm not disputing that, it's just another level of
concern.
Monitoring on our part.
Yeah, so what was the first question of whether we should do this?
Yeah.
That's a yay for me, yeah.
So, let's go around this.
Wait, I gotta write notes.
Let me know when you're in.
So, we should do
change from a per head to an hourly. That's the motion that's on the floor that David just made.
Yep.
Do I hear this?
Let's back up. I don't think this is a vote. Again, we are a committee, and we're gonna make recommendations to the Board of Selectmen, because they're the ones who implement the policy.
Yeah.
All right, so it's not what we'd say.
So we're voting on a recommendation then?
I would, my suggestion would be, we lay all of our information out, and.
We have to put it in the documents, I would present to them.
Present, and say, we looked at this, here are the strengths of it, here are the disadvantages to it. We think this is what we should be doing, here's why. But, so they have an understanding.
Okay, so what
done.
Do we want to put in that doc? Go ahead.
I just have a question. All right, so I think that, yes, it should be more of an hourly because they have, it's easier to manage as far as the schedule and stuff, so this is a lot easier. But do we have to take into consideration the percentage of people that participate within an organization to rent it that are out of town, you know, out of town residents? Because we're working for the town, it's a recommending from town of Newbury. But we're within a tri-regional district. So is there a different rate that we get? So we still are in that bind of finding out what the roster is in order to, if we work with a non-residence and residence.
I think they all have to go through that. I think every town has to, they put together some kind of budget, because that's one of the things that, like, as the cities, they, people that are 100% in the city, there's no charge for those.
Right.
Yeah. And so,
what I'm saying is, we're not really getting away from finding out rosters and things like that either.
We are
right?
To a certain extent.
Yeah, we just aren't having a fee schedule per person. What we're doing is we're going to have a per hour instead of a per person.
But Shamish referred, what Michelle's referring to is, well, what tier would they fall into? What percentage of in town versus out of town?
But
I think out of town, I think
outside of the three districts or just Newbury?
It's Triton Youth. So it's 100% Triton, not necessarily.
Which is all three towns.
I think we have to be sensitive to the fact that we're in a regional system.
Yes.
Right.
So it's okay if it's those youth towns.
Even though the towns of Raleigh and Salisbury have their own setup and they're based off of their towns only.
That's when Mark brought that up a while ago about that too.
This is, it's like Salisbury has their own thing, Raleigh has their own thing, but where the problem is, the school is in our district, is in our town, so we have to be able to be cognizant of that. It, or do we? I think we need to because it's in our town.
Flag football, that's a regional, they play in Salisbury.
I didn't answer.
That's Salisbury residents only.
No, it's not.
It's not?
Yeah, my neighbor's kids play.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but it.
Because it's over Newbury.
It was like the, let's just say, when the girls softball used to play, the elementary girls softball, they're all Newbury residents in theory.
Because Raleigh has their own team.
Yeah, exactly. So if we had a field, if we ran the field, there was a field at the recreation area that we have right now, then we would say, yeah, they get to play there for free. But now it's under the jurisdiction of what? Of the elementary school?
The two fields behind Newbury Elementary are run through the school, currently run through the Newbury Elementary School.
And I think that was the whole idea too about having a field, instead of, you know, having these groups, Triton Youth, GPS, take everything, that we have some space that is free for town residents to go onto.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what the...
Well, that was what they voiced during the meeting last year.
Yeah.
And we said we would make sure that we incorporate that in somehow, or at least start working towards that.
All right, so let's get back to your point about still needing rosters. I think it's safe to assume that if it's coming from, we'll ask for the rosters, but it's not going to...
Dan,
thank you
very
much.
Thank you so much.
Check into the meeting every once in a while.
You can catch us online too, because they're all on tape.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
And they really don't get much funner than this, so I think. Is that a word, funner?
No. It's more fun.
More fun.
So there's really no way to get around that.
Right.
But I think it's safe to assume that.
I think that it's good to have rosters. You know, at least we have names of people.
Yeah. And we take the. I mean, we're gonna have to take them. It's a honor policy where you're gonna have to tell them what town they're from if we have to question it. But if it's part of the Triton Youth Soccer League, you would think they're a part of the.
Yeah, and they're getting a tier amount, so whatever that amount is, $6, $7, $8.
How many tiers we decide to have?
I like to keep it as little as possible, so we don't get it confusing for everybody.
Yeah, but, you know, one tier would be free for
all Newbury residents.
All Newbury residents. Tier number two would be.
This is the Newbury Rec Committee. Is that what you're looking for?
Nope.
But you found us nonetheless.
Well, you know, the room is the first one you go to.
Yeah.
Where are you looking for?
Concom?
Dan just left.
I thought they said it over the library.
I think he said the library.
Yeah.
Oh. Oops.
No problem.
Okay, hold on a second. We can maybe make sure. It might be.
I just think if we had one, if we put a tier in. I booked this room. I know I did.
Yes.
Yes.
Well,
this is recreation.
Oh, recreation?
Yes.
Not the commission?
No.
They're finding out
they're
right
out right
where
now
it's
it
going to be.
Yeah.
Oh, they're trying to find out where
if you want to hold on a second, we'll let you know.
Okay, thank you.
We think it's at the library.
The library?
So, well, I even though Ipswich didn't said that they did not ever write to anybody else, like, because they haven't been approached, I'm assuming. They do have three approved users, people that can write to the
Elm Street.
So that's like
tiers. Yeah.
Well. The first one would be the youth, adult, or nonprofit organizations with 100% approved residents. That includes Little League, they include sports, school sports. All members are residents or employees of local businesses and with no fee. Then the second tier is youth, adult, or nonprofits that is 50% Ipswich residents, and then it's $15 an hour. The third tier is youth, adult, or nonprofit organization less than 50% Ipswich residents, $20 an hour. The first two tiers, this asterisk, residency proof required on rosters of players and managers with addresses and phone numbers for those categories. 50% of the fee is due when they fill out the application. Balance is due at the end of the season with adjustments for dates not used due to schedule or weather conditions.
And then it goes back to Selena's original question, monitors that. Unless we just say, the only way they can't use the field or shouldn't use the field is the days when we say it's not playable. I have certainly no problem putting the notification up on the website. I just can't look at the field because I'm not there. And I'm not.
Well, that's not getting ahead of our story.
I know, in that regards.
So I think.
Was that the first question?
I can write a blurb about why we want to do this, the pros and the cons. The way it was, why we decided to look at it,
mm-hmm.
what we found other towns were doing, what we feel the recommendation, so the question is the recommendation overall that we feel we should switch to an hourly rate?
Mm-hmm. I think so.
And I mean, are we agreeing to that?
Yes.
And then I can write that blurb for the next meeting.
Again,
because you're saying you need to write a whole proposal.
I would suggest spread it out instead of just saying, here's the sheet. That,
right.
Because they're going to have a lot of questions. I'd rather have them have background information to digest and then be able to pick from that.
Okay. So does somebody want to write and maybe recommend tiering how we want to do this? Yes.
It's probably said the Ipswich one, right, that Michelle has.
What?
The one that you just read for.
Well, some of them are five, some
yeah,
of them are two, and some of them are three.
But I'm just saying the
so
one
maybe
that
someone
she...
should dissect really what's the best way to...
Can I see that too?
Yeah, to which is the best one, because I think five is a lot.
It is, but
there's
the problem is to break it out.
Or maybe they just haven't revamped it in a while.
There's a reason for
2013.
Because if you don't include what it is, then you sort of get to say what you are. If you don't fit neatly into one of these five, that's a different. If you don't fit neatly into two, then you can say, I'm not this, I'm not, what am I?
Do you guys think we should?
Well, I think we can keep it to as many as we think is appropriate, but we can also put a stipulation in that it's at the discretion of the rec committee as
yeah.
far as what an organization, if there's a question
yeah.
about where they fall into the tiers,
yeah.
is that what you're saying?
I think it's best to spell it out as clearly as we can. One of the challenges, say, with the nonprofit is, and Dave can attest to this, so there are organizations that, by tax identification, are nonprofits, but they have a huge budget and a huge salary, which is a lot different, salary people and staff, very different than a Triton Little League. Program, Newberry Little League, which has all volunteers.
Yeah, so maybe we should stay away from the word nonprofit.
I think it's probably a wise idea. Do we know, and I don't know the GPS rosters, are those mostly made up of Newberry, Rowley, and Salisbury?
No, it's Kathy M. John T.
Well, I can just say for more than one team, she's the only person, I think, from Newberry on her team.
I'm looking at this and it's like you have 100% Ipswich residents. If we did 100% Newbury residents, I think we'd be in our best idea if we did charge a fee for that. Where if you then tear it out after, but it's a question of what you feel more comfortable doing.
But again, going back to what we Celine initiated a while back, we're a regional.
Right.
None of our, except for baseball. None of our programs, whether it's Triton Youth Hockey, Triton Youth Football, Triton Youth Cross, Soccer, any of those teams, they all take from, add from.
And even then, there are kids that would put choice in from another and participate on a baseball team that don't actually live within this town of three.
So we just say Triton Youth Four.
I think there's a deeper conversation to have.
Well,
what's happened? We got to make the thing about it. We can sit and beat this to the nth degree, but we're going to have to present something, and we got to make a decision on something. And we have 30 minutes tonight. We have an hour and a half next week, and I don't think we should be spending the next 2.5 months going through this and just looking at every possible scenario that's out there, because we've got to start making decisions, that's what the town did.
Does somebody want to take on the tiers and how, make a recommendation? I mean, we had made an initial recommendation way back when, so, but if we need to elaborate on that, that's fine.
That was part of the subcommittee that you worked together.
How many tiers did you?
Three.
Yeah, three.
Yeah.
But it's not, I mean, it's not a legal, I mean, legal needs to look at it to make sure it's, we just kind of.
Again, all we're doing is we're drafting a recommendation with our supporting information, and then the ones are gonna come back and say, yes, no, or whatever. And if they don't like what we have, then we're gonna go back to them and say, well, why not, and let's find ways to fix it and agree upon it.
When did we write that recommendation?
October, November, December of last year. I want to say December.
Yeah, I guess that's also, so the group that, the men's league that was but is no longer.
The old town,
that were just Byfield, the Newbury residents. And, but they were also playing other teams from other jurisdictions, okay. So I think that, yeah, I think it should be in town.
In town or in district?
Well, in town, like the first one, grant the first tier for free, it should be in town
only,
non-outside games. So, you know, we could say, okay, yeah, the girls from Triton that are playing softball could come use our field, but also now they're bringing in people from, you know, other towns, so it becomes a fee situation.
The hard thing we have right now is all we have access to right now, the fields are really only designed for
soccer
lacrosse.
So which works out well.
Yeah, so it's, I mean, not that we couldn't later on down the line get access or have jurisdiction over the baseball, softball, or any other situation, basketball, whatever, you never know.
Yeah.
But right now it's just the only two sports that are playing. So I don't think that first one's ever going to happen.
Yep.
Currently, it's constructed because these programs are designed on a district level.
Yep.
Not
yep.
So, but I opinion.
Going back to our policy manual that was approved by the board of selectmen, section B is a priority status of the field users. It would be in our best interest to sort of maintain that same parallel, so there isn't confusion as to you fall under section B number 2, but in a fee schedule it's number 3.
Right.
So what are the groups that list on the phone?
First one is residents of Newbury, the recreation committee or town department committee or board.
That would be free.
Right.
Newbury, Byfield, and Triton youth sport leagues.
That would be the 7.
Yeah.
That'd be a part of the second tier.
Second tier.
But that's where we're guessing ballpark for opponent number 7.
3 is Triton Regional School. And again, if for some reason the backfields are shut down at Triton, they might need to use our fields for soccer or for lacrosse.
I think they have to fall into the free category.
They do have in the past given soccer and lacrosse free use of their fields after hours, after all their stuff is done. Turf field, you still have to pay for. The fourth group is the charity, community events, adult leagues.
That was the 15.
That was 15.
And then private clinics, camps, tournaments, or other special uses.
That would be the GPS.
That would be
15.
Okay.
I think it's an excellent idea, Mark. Thank you.
Yeah, it worked out nice.
Amesbury has a fee for per week rental, $9.3 for camps and clinics, $500.
Well, so we calculate, what was that?
9 to 3, Monday through Friday.
9 to 3 is?
6 hours.
Thank you.
30 hours.
So 30 hours times 15 is what?
450.
So that's about the same. When we started calculating it all out, the Byfield arts, it all falls roughly within the same. It's not like huge disparities.
Right.
So if you keep it simple, per hour fee. And fields 5A and B are considered half fields.
Yes.
All right, so we just solved that problem.
Okay.
We just took care of the whole tier thing.
Okay, so where does, just as an example, I'm not.
Go ahead.
The kids want to use it for captain's practices. Where do they fall in?
Try, so it's the free.
Okay.
That's it.
Revs comes in and wants to do a lacrosse clinic.
It was for Triton Youth Lacrosse?
For Triton, for Youth Lacrosse, yeah.
For Triton Youth Lacrosse, it would be $7 an hour.
Okay. GPS or another club program?
15.
15.
Which one do they fall under?
15.
They fall under tier 4.
Okay. I'm not questioning you, I just want
you're
to
you're just throwing a question, this scenario is it could happen.
Yeah.
Okay.
How are we going to answer?
And then we can put our caveat at the end that, which was
the recommendation. Well, that was based on, I think we actually
rental of the field.
So Mark Sullivan, who wants to use it for a gathering of Triton Youth Hockey, how much would he?
A caveat.
We talked about that, let's say like Brad Smith thing would be like
a donation.
That was up until we did the.
Please.
I mean, I'm guessing it's the same
donation.
Thing. How long does he want to use it? And he would use it for Triton Hockey. Is he a Newberry resident?
He's he's a Newberry resident, yes.
Okay, then no. No, are they all?
Like any Triton sport, they do take from.
So that could either fall into the 3 or the 7, depending on what we look at.
Probably 7, but $7 for a field is not an expensive endeavor.
For an hour, depending on how long they play.
Yeah.
Applications
yes.
On a case by
case
basis.
We would like to.
There's going to be a gray area somewhere.
Yeah,
yeah.
I understand.
And that's where the gray area is.
Yeah,
I'm
so that we don't get stuck. Why did you run into this group as opposed to this group? We had there was an issue with town property years ago that they wanted to run into one particular religious organization, but not to another one, which you cannot do. If you rent it to a religious group, rent it to no matter what the denomination is.
As long as one religious group is saying, I'm going to play soccer, right? Another one saying, I'm holding a rally where I'm going to, and David just said, I was just kidding, I'm burning stakes, I'm not going to do it to the second group because the actions that you're going to use are detrimental to the field.
Yeah, the community in a whole.
Yeah.
In switches. Playing fields, general rules and regulations, it does say that applications for field usage may be denied to any or all groups when the cemetery or parks department has determined that an overplaying situation has begun to occur and or determined becomes detrimental to park maintenance. So, I mean, you put those things in, and I would imagine that, I know what the concern is that you don't want people questioning, but I would imagine
we're trying to be fair
and
even to everybody, but we have
on
to.
Record anyway as
yeah.
to why you're determining whether someone can rent.
I mean, the question is, what do other towns do? Because we're not the first ones to switch to this and try and work out a tier structure. So I think if we miss something, legal will pick it up. No?
I think that if 3-tier sounds perfect.
Well, we're at 5. No, we're going to dovetail it with the 5.
Oh, yeah, which works.
Okay, yeah.
The overuse stuff is in here about damage
yeah.
and whatnot. So that's already covered.
The only thing it looks like we have left to really put together into it is the field house and how it, as Celine says, dovetails into the policy. Unless I'm missing something, because what you had here, change of policy, what we charge, the tiers, implementation. So outside of, I should say, assistance. still need to implement it.
The question that you sort of alluded to earlier in terms of rain date and refunds, this goes to how do teams, I mean, we could run into the same issue at $7 an hour, whatever the magic number is. I'll rent it out from 8 in the morning to 6 at night. I have the money to do that. So that doesn't really solve one of the objectives that we were going for, which was to, and I don't have an answer to this, I'm just bringing this up. Our objective was to try to create more space and hold them accountable. If they just rent it at this as an hourly rate as opposed to just $35 a kid, we still have that dilemma. And the question sort of becomes, how do they, whatever organization, make up their rainout games? How do we, I don't say make it easy, but they, as a client, how do we make it work?
Well, I think that the idea of going to a per hour fee, we're gonna have control and they're not gonna have, so right now, let's just say, here are the fields, and the use is all blue, so everything's blue. We don't, no one can use anything in that field. But when this new tiers work out, a new per hour, there'll be openings in that.
You think so?
Yeah.
I think so, because they're going to be more mindful of their
budget.
I'm saying, that's one thing we talked about.
And we should also.
And they're not going to want, and this, you know, if they don't want their fees to go up, they need to pay attention to how much time they're renting.
Yeah, and that's.
And right now, you're charging $35 a player to rent 2.5 fields for however many hours you want.
Yeah.
And then the other group does the same thing for, they're the same price.
Yeah.
How much is it per hour for a soccer team? Trading $7 an hour?
Yeah.
So on any weekday from 3 to 7,
yep.
We're talking about 28?
Times 2.5 fields.
What was that again? Is it 28?
Times 13 weeks.
13 weeks? Most of your seasons.
Because
we go into that question, it's usually a 10-week, 11-week season, and then the first 2 weeks they don't play.
Right, that's what part of the thing needs to be figured out.
You said 28 hours?
I don't know, Mark said 28 hours, yeah.
We maybe one of the things that I mentioned was
that's
before.
70 times 13 weeks, and then that times 7.
Times 5 days. Times 7.
$7 an hour.
Yeah.
2.5 times 13 equals times 7. That's 63.7. Their last bill was like $4,000 or $5,000. They did 20. If that's what we did, 28 hours. 2.5 fields, 13 weeks, $7 an hour is $63.10.
So it won't be $6,310. I don't know where I got 13 weeks
from.
One of the applications had, maybe it was last fall.
28 times 2.5 fields times
7.
Just that per week is $490. Tell me how many hours, how many weeks going? 10, $4,900. Just gives you an idea. On an average, you're gonna spend $490 a week for 2.5 fields. How many weeks they choose, that's their call. They shift it down to 2 fields, they can save some money. Field and a half, they can save some money.
And they can't sublease.
That's a key thing.
So
that was
that's,
you had mentioned the crisscrossing.
Yeah, and that's
what
why.
What do you not like about it? I get the sense you don't like it. You're just
I have a deep pocket. I'm just gonna raise everybody's fee, and I'm still gonna rent the same amount.
Then we make out.
We make money. And this is, and the
not
thing.
You're not going to do that for the youth.
Yeah. And
why not?
Then what's your recommendation?
I just want us to have the dialogue so we understand the different angles of it. I don't have an answer right now. I may never have an answer. I don't know. There's it's not going to be easy. What we're doing is really hard. And it's not to. It's to look at it and be cognizant of the different angles of it. Because technically, you could say GPS could come in, or Let's, Aztec soccer program comes in and says, we want 8 fields, we want all the fields.
And they'd have, that'd be our discretion, that would be our discretion.
I mean, that's our discretion, because we can't, we're not gonna give you the whole thing.
First of all, they're not a priority.
Okay.
They're not a priority tier.
Okay.
Our youth teams are the priority tier, and our residents are a priority. So we can say, you know what, we don't wanna rent that many fields, we want, we'll give you this much.
We'll want this much up until this point, we'll check the other fields, if no one else does it, then you have first right of refusal, if you want more.
I mean, I think we, yeah.
And I think with this, with this, with this tier, we may find that keeping Triton Youth Sports, so they, I don't know what the situation is with them, how they're making money, not making money. But if we can keep it at where they're at right now, and then look at it next year, if we should be bringing up the price to get even close to some of the other towns as per hour. So maybe that's something that we should look at in the future about bringing up the, those outside users that were charging $15.
I mean, it's gonna, there's gonna be a shakeout period where we may lose some people and then get some new people, or we may not, or, and growing pains, so to speak.
Yeah.
There's gonna be some kinks that are gonna need to be worked out, and that's why I think in 2 years or something we should reevaluate, not to raise rates, but just to evaluate if it's working or not working, and
yep.
pragmatic or not pragmatic.
Because we find that all of a sudden it's not the right scenario, or we're seeing that trends are going back to where it was, and maybe we look at it. I mean, we need to give it a couple of years just to let it settle and really get an idea.
I still think that there's, it, to me, we know that the fields are over rented, over reserved.
I take exception to that. I think September, I think you're right, during the spring, they are. Because we have two different sports using it. I think in the fall, because you have 5 fields and only soccer program, 2 soccer programs use it, there's more availability, so we can rest fields. I think spring is the issue, and I think in summer, there's not enough use.
But in the fall, if someone said, hey, I wanna start a Frisbee league, they can't do it in the fall, because aren't those all the fields booked, basically?
The spring is the fall. The fall we have a little bit more leeway if we needed to.
But how's that, where's the jurisdiction on that? I mean, what goes on in the fall? Does it just, do they just decide what fields they're gonna play on? They don't?
The youth would have the first.
No, I'm saying at the way it's run right now, the situation.
Oh no, right now they've just blocked it off.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying.
Currently the way it sits, no one has a chance fall or spring.
Yeah.
Because they just take them over.
So we can't have that anymore.
And that was the problem. That was the reason why.
Well, and I think that's why we had such a problem with the adult leagues. The problem wouldn't have been there. Admittedly so.
Yeah. And I do think that, let's just say that, you know, we lose somebody, I think that there'll be lots of people that will be in line to fill that void.
Especially when they see our rates compared to other towns.
Yeah. And especially from what I understand from talking to rec departments, hearing that there's always calls to that.
All we gotta do is get the word out.
Yep.
And we probably fill it. $15 an hour for that. I think we could do the 10 and the 20, but I'm worried about the youth at the 10.
I worry about the youth at the 10.
That's my concern.
I don't
want to. That's where a comment to say we are trying to raise rates.
Can I ask an email with that?
Yes.
Were they invited here, or was it just
a
question?
I asked them to come to a meeting or give us a written response.
Nothing.
No, I will be in contact with them.
Okay.
20.
I see some of these opportunities. Yes, teams can come here and eventually kids could change teams, but there is an advantage for our taxpayers to have their kids go to Central Street Fields for practice as opposed to who am I thinking of? Out by Lexington, we had practices for lacrosse.
But what kind of lacrosse is it? Is it a club league or is
it's
it?
A club.
It's a club.
Yeah. See, to me, I could be totally wrong on this, but when you have your kid, you guys probably have kids in club leagues. You know, you're paying extra money, and so therefore, there's travel, a lot of travel
yeah,
involved.
I drove for lacrosse down to the South Shore. We've driven to Harvard for practices.
I know.
You're driving up into New Hampshire, out west part of the state for basketball.
I actually
don't think that that benefits the Newbury taxpayers, that it's convenient for the club players to be able to just come nearby.
Yeah.
But that, it helps the parents.
That's when the taxpayers, yeah.
Right, but not all taxpayers in the town.
No, I'm not suggesting.
I mean, it's convenient, it's great.
If you just go by the 15, Morgan's the only, Felice's the only person from Newbury that's on her club soccer team. There are some girls from Pennsylvania, there's somebody from Gloucester, there's somebody from Georgetown. So yes, the proximity to where the practices are is definitely a pull, because, you know, there's not gonna be another club team that's right next door to where we are.
And I think that's what GPS was saying too, when we talked to him.
Although there is one in Amesbury.
Yeah, he said that for him, having a location here is great for him, because it's in a central location where all those kids come from, so.
Well, yeah, so, I mean, as much as you might not like that this is changing, because now he has to probably mind his hours of rental. It's to his benefit to be in this area, geographic area,
yep,
as well. I think that the hourly rate is more beneficial for the town. If you weren't a parent of a child, if you're an older adult and you want to be able to actually go down to the field area, or and you want to see free space available,
mm-hmm,
for town residents, and if we're trying to fill that need, the hourly rate works great, because then there's more open space available. Well,
it was that, as well as the ability where we're not waiting for Rochester to come in and having to wait to get all the information. Here it's like, you tell us what you want for hours, you guys handle your rosters and how you want to do it all, and then you know what you have for hours.
Right.
And then we're not, as we talked about, we're not at the will of the league waiting for
that. No,
to come,
I know,
out.
Yeah, those benefits.
So those
are
those
jealousies. I'm just thinking for people that don't have,
exactly,
any kids that are in any kind of sports,
yeah,
that are looking at all this and saying, why are they doing this? It's managing the time of the field being used better. Thereby hopefully reducing costs to the town in the general maintenance and upkeep of the fields. Just having the ability to be able to rest fields, and you know, if they're not like everywhere on the field.
All right. I'm only saying this because it's 5 minutes left before I have to leave. You guys can continue talking if you want to. If not, we can wrap it either way. But if we're going to wrap it, we should kind of at least leave, know we are, and head for the next
meeting. Can I just add one more thing?
Sure.
The hourly thing, if people are more cognizant of the hours that they're renting, there's now, when we have an issue, if hopefully we won't have any more issues with field damage, but wet spots or whatever, managing the time might be able, it loosens the noose a little bit.
More chance of fields
arrest. More flexibility for people to move around the field.
Are you suggesting that if you look, for example, soccer has 3 and 4, that 3 is wet, can they go to field 2?
No, I mean, as far as opening the fields or damage to the field, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
Not on a daily.
Okay.
Because either the fields are open or they're closed.
Currently, they're
well, we've been known to rest fields at a time, saying, yeah, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5 fields are open, field 4 is shut down because of,
yeah, and we should be able to, if we know where people are, we should be able to manually move people around.
Yeah. That the shutting of the field down is outlined in our earlier document.
Yeah.
Currently we sort of embrace the fields are open or they're closed. Having walked through fields sometimes twice a day, there are some fields that could be open where others would need to be closed. And I don't know, that's something we want to include in field 3 is shut down. Again, our major users, they would understand it because they have a vested interest in making sure it stays usable and safe, but we can open up 5 and 3 and 1. Just so that.
Okay, that's another layer.
Yeah.
I can't take on any layers. I mean, there's other, so we've done the first two sections.
Yeah.
We're
going to hourly. We did say we should change to, we've done the tiers. We've actually done the first three that you had in your list here. The implementation is one thing we haven't finalized yet.
To work on.
and then the field house. Those are the five things that you mentioned. So we've gotten three, the fourth, we just gotta figure how we wanna handle it, and then the fifth. I think if, with what we've done tonight, again, it's entirely your decision. I just know I have to, so I apologize. If we wanna, you guys wanna continue this, it's entirely your call. Just missed the end of it. If not, then any, if we're gonna end this in the next minute or two, then what is everybody's opinion? So where do we wanna go for the next meeting?
A couple of things for the next meeting, if you could add into the agenda, well, this is part of the big picture. If everybody could review and send feedback about the field house.
Yeah, I did, I ran through it.
And give feedback, and I can consolidate it, and then.
Well, and now you know roughly where we're going here, so you can kind of.
Yep.
So I'll re-pull this together in kind of a proposal type form in my free time. And then we'll move on to this part next time.
Yeah, cause that's really the last big piece of it.
Can on the agenda be included a decision of costs and reserving the space for Mark Sullivan and Trenton Youth Hockey?
I don't even remember what that was for again.
They wanted to have a celebration there, and a couple of dates picked out.
So what are they looking for? Just to have a cookout, or are they just gonna play?
They're looking to have open space to just gather the team. It's nice, hopefully it's a nice day, and they may have a pickup game of something going on, just open space.
Do we have any idea how many fields are we looking at, and dates and?
The dates were all sent, they were looking at.
Why do I not have that?
I don't remember seeing any of those.
I've never seen that at all.
I've kept on that.
Sorry, Mark, it's not ringing a bell.
Yes, first I've heard.
I vaguely remember him bringing it up at a meeting, but I don't remember physically seeing anything.
I just thought that it had something to do with the.
So it's kind of an application for, is a one-day event, a one afternoon event, that type thing?
Yes.
So I think we still fall within the parameters of.
They're asking June 2nd, June 6th.
June 2nd?
That was back in February when Mark had sent that.
Can you resend that?
I'm going back to it now.
As far as I know, it's probably deserved.
What day was it sent?
February 13th. And so I will send,
Well, it was way back, yeah. I just found it.
I mean, that still falls within the parameters of the old fee, and I, for the, me, like, I would think that a donation.
Any kind of a donation they feel is just.
If we can squeeze them in the schedule.
That's, the thing is, June 2nd is graduation day, by high school too.
Do they know that?
I don't know, I'm just saying, from 2 to 6, graduation will be over.
I'll send the whole email chain.
Huh, I got it. I just.
Yeah, you actually responded.
I thought it was that sucker thing that.
Celine, you responded three times to this email train too, to see aware of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just give you an idea how crazy that must have been.
Yeah.
Oh, she only responded once.
I got one response for her.
Yeah.
So unless you just, that's the way mine looks. This is, looks like three times.
Since there is no
but maybe it'd be something
that. There may be something you got before the select and now confirm.
They said their dates are flexible, but they're
not watching. Just, we don't have policy as to donation, and
then they can have, if they can fit it in, then they can have it for free. I'm okay with that.
It's just a question.
I don't. I need to know how many feet. I think everything's booked. Your lives are
problem. Which we'll soon.
Saturdays are practice for one set of teams, which means they usually get over pretty early unless something else comes up. So it'd just be a matter of contacting,
approaching
them and saying, look, because a lot of those fathers also play, are involved in hockey, so it's.
Got it, understood.
Yeah, and soccer games get overlicensed.
All right, so I'm adding the fieldhouse document and the decision and cost for Mark Sullivan to next week's meeting.
Awesome.
We're still on for next Wednesday from 6:30 to 8. I was telling Celine earlier, I will do my best to make it because I'll be coming from Boston.
6:30?
6:30. Yeah, you come.
I'll be back with my dad that day, so I will do the best I can to get back. If I cannot, I will certainly email ahead of time. But I will post this, the meeting has to be posted by Thursday. So I'll put the agenda up. It's gonna have the same exact thing with the exception of the two additions. If anybody wants to add anything between now and Thursday, please let me know.
Except that we're really trying to keep this as not.
Yeah, we're trying to.
Yes. That's the whole idea, because we're trying to stay focused on this and nail as much as we can with it.
Okay, just give you an update on Mello.
Okay.
So are people gonna work on the next part, Mark's section over the week?
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm
gonna try and get to it, but I'm also, I wanna get this stuff all in writing too, so I will try later.
I'm just gonna take your Word doc, because he's got a Word doc, if you just put the track, your changes in, that makes it easier. So you don't have to retype or do anything. I handwrote mine, and then I'm just gonna update it onto that. And I'll forward it up to the group, at least mine. Some of it's questions, some of it's just clarifications.
Okay, good.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?